So let's continue with symptomatology by Stuart Close. So what is symptom? Any evidence of disease or change from the state of health is called as symptom. Now, nature never trifles. That is, any symptom which may seem trifling to a careless examiner may be the key to unlock a difficult problem. Many a times the doctor who works in my clinic comes and asks me that how come you are able to see certain things which I am not able to appreciate, and how come I miss this particular point in the patient. It is nothing, that it comes with your skill and experience and you being unprejudiced, that you learn many things with way. Now, I had a patient who was just sitting with me, and I was treating that patient for thyroiditis. She had hoarseness of voice and thyroid complaints, and I was giving her medicines and she was feeling better. But of course, I understood that my medicine was not right because it was not the result I had expected. One day when she was during the consultation, she was sitting with her husband and talking, and I just asked her like, how are you today? And then she told me that, as usual, I am better, but I am very tired and exhausted, and I have to do all the job myself, and it's all very difficult. Then I could see the husband's face, who was, it was just like a sarcasm or a mocking smile. And I told, sir, do you have to tell anything on this matter? And he told me that how naturally she'll feel very weak and tired, because even if I want to help her, she is not ready to take my help. Now, if I and my daughter, we wash some vessels or we clean a particular area, she does not like it and she does it again. She has to wash it minimum 2 to 3 times to get to feel that it is clean, So plus, if we do it, she is never satisfied with that. And this is not only about the glass. If you come to my home, you'll be shocked, doctor, it is so clean. Even with this job of morning 9 to 5, she remaining full effort she put up in cleaning the house. Now, of course, her fastidiousness gave way to the drug, which was the right medicine for her, and ourselves was prescribed. But a small thing which might miss our eye, we may miss the drug. So nature never trifles. Even a small trifling or a small thing is very important in every case. Now let's see what is symptom according to Hahnemann. Any manifestation of deviation from former state of health perceptible by patient, the individuals around him or the physician is called a symptom. Now prior to Hahnemann, two things were ignored. Believe me, other than homeopathy, many other systems even neglect these two things, that is the mental symptoms and the subjective symptoms. Still, I have got so many patients who come to my clinic and tell, I have been to so many doctors, but nobody gave so much effort or even tried to listen to what I'm talking. By the time I tell, they are halfway prescribing and they tell us, it's okay, you will get better, you just take these medicines and send me off. You are the first person who took the effort to even listen and understand and try to ask me what I am actually feeling. So till that, even now, two things which are ignored are mental symptoms and subjective symptoms. Now, what is subjective symptoms? These are the symptoms which are discovered by patient alone. For example, all different kinds of pains and sensations, stitching pain, burning pain, weird sensation, something is there in the abdomen, something is there in my head. All those pains and sensation are subjective symptoms. That is symptoms which are discovered by patient alone. They enable the physician to view disease from standpoint of patient. From patient's point of view, they help us. Their absence make it difficult. We don't actually understand the importance of subjective symptoms until unless you are made to treat a case where there are no subjective symptoms. For example, in case of infants, many a time you find it very difficult. Now, what do you do in such cases when there are no subjective symptoms? The only thing there very important is your observation and all your senses, that is your eyes and ears and your nose, which help you along the way to prescribe for the patient. Like how does a child want to be carried, or whether the child wants to be carried, or is the child jumping from mother to father and father to mother, that is capriciousness, what it's called. Or is a child asking for things? Is a child stubborn? Is a child shy? All these things you can get only by observation, because otherwise there are no subjective symptoms when infants are considered. So subjective symptoms are very important. You know the importance only when you don't have it. Now, Hahnemann opened path for different types of pains and sensations. Can you believe? Now we tell burning pain, of course, cantharis, arsal, sulfur, so many drugs, stitching pain, bryonia. So now we have got so many medicines, but because of Hahnemann, just because of Hahnemann, he opened the path to different types of pain and sensation. Now, what are objective symptoms? Hahnemann's objective symptoms are expression of disease in sensation and functions of that side of organism exposed to the senses of the physician and bystander. Now, I'll tell you a very beautiful case which tells its importance. That is, I had a patient who came to me and he was telling that husband and wife had both come, and the wife was doing most of the talking because the husband was the patient and he was undergoing abdominal pain. Now, she told me he has not passed stool for nearly 5 days. And he's having abdominal cramps, there is bloating, he feels nauseous, he's not able to eat. And of course, when they had taken a report, it was found out that he has got small bowel obstruction. Now, they were advised by the doctors to immediately do a surgery. But the doctor told, I give you a 1 week's time, please come and get admitted. Now, that patient, their full family is a homeopathic family, they all take homeopathic medicine. So this patient came and told that, no, we don't want to go for surgery. Please do something, you to help me out. Now, when I heard about it's a small bowel obstruction, you know, sometimes we should never try to become God or a hero. I was like, okay, but let's see. I have 1 week time. If I'm able to help this patient, it will be a big deal. So when I saw the patient, all the symptoms she told, which were the common symptoms of small bowel obstruction. When I saw the patient, I noticed that every few minutes, when the wife was saying a minute or two, he used to just go behind like this, you know, just stretch him backwards. Now, this just didn't happen once, but almost 5 to 10 times during the consultation. So I asked the man, sir, why are you doing that? You know, what exactly is it? Why are you doing that? And he told me, you know, whenever the pain comes, I feel better if I do that, you know, bend backwards. And voila, it hit the remedy. And the medicine given was Dioscorea. Yes, we study it often in Metra Medica, but we never know when it comes handy in our practice. Now, this objective symptom, why it is objective, it was not told by the patient. Only by my observation, I could make out that he is doing that particular thing. And believe me, Dioscorea helped. The patient didn't have to go for surgery and he's fine and he's still under our treatment. This happened just 2 months back. He's still under our treatment and he's doing much better. So objective symptoms are very important. Now, totality of symptoms. Now, it is the true and only basis for every homeopathic prescription. Totality represents both disease as well as remedy. Now, there are three totalities according to Stuart Plus. And when totality of symptoms, if it comes for your exam, you can always write as Stuart Plus point of view, or you can write all those things I have been showing this. Of course, this will be uploaded in my YouTube channel. You want, you can copy it down from the slides there and you can write it for your exam. Now, there are three totalities, that is totality of each individual symptom first. Okay. Now, totality of symptoms of the case. Then third, totality of symptoms in Metra Medica. Now, totality of each individual symptom. Now, each single symptom has more than one fact, you know, the history, the origin, location, its progress and direction, and conditions. Now, each complete symptom, when we tell about a symptom, I used to always tell the doctor who's working in my clinic, try to make the symptom as complete as possible. That is, each single symptom, you take everything, the location, the sensation, the modalities, the associated symptoms, everything, try to make it maximum complete. Why? Now, how are we supposed to take each complete symptom under these three elements? Now, let's see location. When you tell location, we usually mention only the part, but no, the part, the origin, like where it first started, the tissues or functioning of the body or mind in which symptom appears. Okay. Now, a direction, this is also important, because when you tell that, how do you understand the patient is cured? You always tell about the Herring's law of cure. But if you don't have the proper order in which the symptoms appeared, then how will you know that the patient is getting cured in the reverse order of the appearance? So for knowing the way of appearance or reverse order, first you should know the appearance of the symptoms, which is mentioned in location. Now the sensations, it means impression upon the entire system through sensory or efferent nerves. Both mental or physical symptoms are considered in written, everything details written in sensation. Now modalities, circumstances and conditions which modify a symptom are called as modalities. It includes the aggravation and the amelioration. Now totality of symptoms of a case. Okay. Now when you tell about a case, in totality, all symptoms of a case which are capable of being logically combined into a harmonious and consistent whole, having form, coherence, and individuality. Sorry, I can't change these words because this is the definition of totality. Okay. Now, according to Hahnemann, the definition of totality was very easy, which I love to tell. That is, outward reflection of the internal essence of the disease is called as totality. Now, totality, when you tell, it must express an idea, like totality of what? So there are two totalities, okay? The diagnostic idea and the therapeutic idea. Now, the diagnostic idea is that certain symptoms have pathological relation to each other, and upon this is based the diagnosis. Now, the therapeutic idea is that totality of symptoms upon which is based the homeopathic prescription. Now, many a times I have heard people tell that in homeopathy, the uncommon and the characteristic symptoms are to be given higher importance. True, but we should never neglect the common diagnostic symptoms, because you have to remember that there's a common statement used that we in homeopathy, we treat the patient and not the disease. True, we treat the patient, but the disease is a part of the patient. You can't leave the diagnostic or common symptoms outside. The medicine should cover the characteristic symptoms, but it should be able to cover even the diagnostic or common symptoms too. Because the whole idea is, if a medicine cannot produce it, then how can it cure it? Okay. So overall, you really require the differentiation between the diagnostic and the therapeutic totality. So totality is not haphazardly jumble of symptoms, but it is the sum aggregate of the symptoms, not mere numerical aggregate, but organic whole as an individuality. When I'm talking about Stuart Close, a point of even Kent, Dr. Kent is coming to my mind, where he tells that about that, when we start our practice, when you have finished our BHMS and we are starting our practice, we take case, we take it in so much detail that you have got all so many symptoms, but you don't have the case. So too many symptoms is not. How you logically put them together and take the important things and see which drug matches it most is the most important thing. So it's not a haphazard jumble of all the symptoms. It is but taken by proper, you know, logical deduction, you come to understanding of that particular totality. So what is genius of remedy? This is an important short note. But what it means is that it is the essential principle of the remedy which gives it its individuality. For example, you think that you can, if you think of noxomica, the common symptom which will run through your mind is that urging for stool. If you think of Merxol, you will always think of humidity and excess of secretions and increased salivations. So what is the genus of remedy? It is the essential principle of the remedy which gives it its individuality. Now, Rogue's Gallery. This is a very important question. It comes as a short note. And when I was doing my BHMS, this has come for my exam. And believe me, I didn't write the answer that time because I myself knew the answer. It took a lot of searching to find out that it comes from Stuart Close. So what is Rogue's Gallery? Now, most of you will be interested into, you know, fiction, suspense, and, serials where it shows a lot about, you know, police and how they have. Nowadays, all the data is digitalized. Like, if a person is a criminal and you just like his fingerprint or his details or his face, they can make out like whether he's a criminal or not. But earlier days, if a person was a thief or has done something bad or is a criminal, then a gallery is to be there, like a wall where they used to put that so-and-so person is a criminal and he has done murder or he has done kidnaps. So a gallery used to be there. So Stuart Close compares Metramedica with this gallery. You know, this because this gallery is a display of the murders of convicts, it is called Rogue's Gallery. So Stuart Close compares Metramedica with this Rogue's Gallery. He tells Metramedica is like Rogue's Gallery, where you have so many drugs put up there on the wall. And your job is to find out a medicine, match the medicine with that of the patient and give it to the patient. So Metramedica is a sum total of the symptoms of all proved medicine. A grand inclusive figure like a Superman. Now Metramedica is like Rogue's Gallery with many medicine. Many medicines are displayed. And it's a physician's job to select the right medicine for the patient. Now the concept is set a thief to catch a thief. Of course, but actually that concept does not work nowadays. You don't set a thief, you know. You set a cop to catch a thief. But that was the idea behind it. That is, Rogue's Gallery is like a gallery of Metramedica where you can compare the medicines and give it to the patient. So totality of symptoms is seen in formation of these five aspects, that is Metramedica as whole. Now totality of every single symptom or every remedy, every symptom of the disease, each disease. So totality is seen in the formation of all these five things. Now, what are the common errors while making totality? Now, this itself is a short note in exam. So pay attention to this part. Now, there are three errors we make while making a totality. That is, the first biggest error we do is that error in giving too much importance or emphasis to single symptom or prescribing on single symptom. The word totality against goes this against the this error. The totality means, you know, group. And the biggest error is to prescribing on single symptom. So don't make the error of making like this. That is taking only one symptom. Totality means it should include everything. Now, error in trying to fit a remedy to a mass of indefinite unrelated symptoms by mechanical comparison of symptoms. That is symptom coverer. I've seen many students, they take the case, they put lot of effort into it, they repertorize. Once they repertorize, they take all the symptoms of the patient into consideration into repertorization. But repertorization should not be done like that. That also is an art, and you will understand when you study repertorization. So they take everything here into the repertorization chart. And then whatever comes, the first remedy will be taken as that matches for the patient. Believe me, it does not work like that, because you have to understand You are not a symptom coverer. For the whole reason behind making of totality is that it is not haphazard mixing of symptoms. It is taking what is important of that case and depending on that, finding the most similar remedy. So you should not become a symptom coverer. Okay. The third important mistake we do, that is pathological prescribers. That is prescribing on basis of pathological diagnosis. Many a times I've seen patients, like for example, if you tell molluscum, then silicea, fistula in ano, silicea, if aphthous ulcer, Merxol. So it's like pathological prescription, only that particular, but there are so many drugs you are missing out there. So it is very important you consider the totality. Now, again, another important short note for your exam, that is day book. So what is a day book? The symptoms of each prover are set down chronologically in the order of occurrence. So day book is a book of the provers where during proving all the symptoms of the prover are written. So they are written chronologically. Now each symptom is complete as possible. Like if patient tells that, if the prover tells I have got burning. Okay, so you have got burning. It's not written like that. Burning which area, when do you feel it is more, when do you feel it is less, whether burning is associated. So each symptom is complete as possible in elements of location, sensation and modality. Then it is noted in layman's plain and simple language. Day book is written in layman's plain and simple language and noted as and when they appear. Now this record along with the remarks and the observation of the director of proving constitutes of proving. It is from this day book Metra Medica is constructed, but the day book of provers are not Metra Medica. Okay, so the day book does not directly become Metra Medica. It has to go through a process. Let's see what it is. Now how does from day book it becomes Metra Medica? A huge mass of symptoms are collected from day book, are then analyzed, sifted, classified anatomically, physiologically, pathologically, then again classified. General and particular characteristics are logically deduced, and then only it becomes the Metra Medica. Sorry. Then comes another part of Stuart Close, that is characteristic symptom. Characteristic symptoms and keynote symptoms. Now first we'll see what is characteristic symptoms. Now, characteristic symptoms, actually the definition is given in aphorism 153 or for Organon of Medicine, and it goes as the more striking, singular, uncommon and peculiar bracket characteristic signs and symptoms of the case are chiefly and almost solely kept in view, for it is more particularly these that very similar ones in the list of symptoms of the selected medicine must correspond to in order to bring cure. So the important thing is, of course you understood the striking, singular, uncommon and peculiar part, but the another part which is very important is that it is this that very similar in the list of symptoms of the medicine. So this has to be covered by the medicine, then only you can give that particular medicine to the patient. So what is a keynote symptom then? See, real keynotes was actually practiced by Dr. Henry N. Guernsey. Actually, he invented a new name for the old idea of Hahnemann characteristics. The word keynote was used to connect the analogy between the music and Metra Medica. That's how, you know, the keynote word comes into this. That's how even, you know, Ellen's keynote. So you should know what is keynote. Now, disease is also called as out of tune or tone. It is actually loss in harmony in functions and sensations. Now, keynote in music. It is a fundamental note in which the whole piece is accommodated. A keynote of the case should match with the keynote of the remedy. If you see, keynote and characteristic symptoms are not two different things. It is the same thing. The characteristic of Hanuman is the keynote of Guernsey. Other people, authors are also given their view on it. Now, for example, if you say Dr. Adolf Lippi, what he has to tell about characteristic symptoms. Now, symptoms peculiar to the individual patient rather than common to the disease. Is example, now he gives a very beautiful example. If you read Stuart Close, you would have seen that he gives an example of cholera. Now, in cholera, one patient had he had got severe sounds in rumbling in his intestines as if water is being poured, and there was gushing out of the stool. The stool you should gush out. So these are the two things, which very important things, which were seen in that particular case. Now at that time, these two symptoms are the characteristic symptom of the medicine Jatropha Kirkus, and it helped him to cure the particular case. Now, Dr. P.P. Wells, actually Stuart Close is big fan of two doctors, if you see, that is Finke and P.P. Wells. So you will see them commonly appearing in all the chapters of Stuart Close. Now, P.P. Wells tells about characteristic symptom that these are the symptoms which individualize both the disease and the drug. Then herring. Now, herring tells that every stool must have at least three legs if it has to stand alone. Now, herring tells about, you know, about a milking stool. There is a stool called as milking stool, which has got only one leg. Then you think, how do you sit on a stool with only one leg? When you sit on the stool, it is your two legs plus a one leg of the stool. So that's how on the three legs you sit. But if a stool, if you see with one leg, do you think it can stand? No. So likewise, any case, if you try to make it stand on only one characteristic symptom, it is going to fall down. The case is just going to fail, or you'll not be able to cure. So at least a case has to be based on three legs, or at least three characteristic symptoms have to be seen. Now, Boninghausen Therapeutic Pocketbook. This is an important part in your syllabus. So I will be taking this particular part. Boninghausen Therapeutic Pocketbook. When I started taking the last session, I first told you that Stuart Close was a big follower of Boninghausen. I don't blame him, because Boninghausen is a very man who, with his theory of grand generalization, brought us a beautiful repertory called as Boninghausen Therapeutic Pocketbook. Now, how was the idea? What was the idea behind this? I'm not going to explain the whole repertory. Don't worry. It is just the important points which you are supposed to write for your exams, which are given in Stuart Close. Okay. Now, what was the theory behind making this Boninghausen Therapeutic Pocketbook? See, what used to happen is that though we tell about complete symptom and you take every details, in your everyday practice, it is not possible to get complete symptom. Many a times you will have location and sensation, but you will not have modalities. Then you will have sensation, you will not have a proper location or modalities. So these things are going to keep on changing. Now, sometimes we come across cases where we have location, as I told, but no sensation. Then you have sensation, no location. Then what do you do in such cases? Sometimes you don't have complete symptom, you have incomplete symptoms. Then what do you do? The answer to this particular situation is Boninghausen Therapeutic Pocketbook. So we will see how BTPB became the answer to this situation. Now, Boninghausen noted that many, not all, many modalities of a case are general in their relation. For example, if you see Pulsatilla, aggravation warm room. First, it was thought that warm room aggravates in case of headache for Pulsatilla. But then when study was made, could find out that almost most of the complaints of Pulsatilla were aggravated in warm room. So this was a true experience, and this was a thing to ring a bell in his head that, of course, generalization will help us solve our problem in incomplete symptom. So to cure such cases where complete symptoms are lacking, Boninghausen came up with a theory of generalization and Boninghausen Therapeutic Pocketbook. So now we could construct a totality even with fragmentary symptoms. So in exam, if a question is asked, like how are you going to deal with the situation where you have incomplete symptoms? Or how are you going to, how incomplete symptoms if you have, then how are you going to deal with it? Then you have to just tell, you take whatever you have and then you use Boningosan therapeutic pocketbook and it helps you to come to a remedy. So there are 7 parts of BTPB. First is moral and intellectual faculty, location or seat of symptoms, then morbid conditions and sensations, sleep and dreams, circulation and fever, modalities, etiology, etc. And the last chapter, concordances, that is relationship of remedies. Now, what are the advantages of BTPB? It overcomes to a great extent the imperfections and limitations of our Metra Medica. Now, what we have studied together from this particular symptomatology chapter, we studied what is symptom, we studied what is objective and subjective and objective symptoms, we studied totality of symptoms, its 3 types, we studied what is genius of remedy and rogues gallery, what is day book, and the day book is not Metra Medica, and the errors while making totality, the characteristic and keynote symptoms, and we studied BTPB, that is Boninghausen therapeutic pocket book. Now with this, our session, this section has come to an end.